World Environment Day, this year's theme is Ecosystem Restoration. And the global host this year in 2021 is Pakistan. And in fact, the United Nations Decade of Ecosystem Restoration has been launched on the 4th of June 2021. In fact, the themes of the previous years were, it started from 1974, that is only one Earth, human settlement 75, and then recently in 2020, in Time for Nature, and this year is Ecosystem Restoration. India has contributed twice in the year 2011 and 2018 in the Forest Nature at Your Service and 2018 Beat Plastic Pollution. The historical background is this, that it is celebrated on 5th of June in the United Nations Principal Vehicle for encouraging awareness and action for protection of the environment. So the World Environment Day was mooted in 1972 at the Stockholm Conference. And 2 years later, in 1974, the first World Environment Day was held with the theme Only One Earth. World Environment Day is a global platform for public outreach with participation of over 143 countries annually. And each year, the program has provided a theme and a forum for business, non-government organization, communities, governments, celebrities to advocate the environmental causes. So there are different articles of the environmental protection: Article 21 of the Indian Constitution, Right to Life; Article 48, Protection and Improvement of Environment and Safeguarding Forests; Article 51A(g) says it shall be the duty of every citizen of India to protect and improve the natural environment, including forests, lakes, rivers, and wildlife, and to have compassion for living creatures. So with this introductory background, I would like to invite our chairman and the director of the Institute, Dr. M. Madhu, to say a few words on this occasion.
Yes, sabko namaskar, and we wish you all a happy World Environmental Day. And my dear senior colleagues and my scientist colleagues and other staff of the Institute, India Institute of Soil and Water Conservation. As usually, on every year, we celebrate World Environmental Day in order to announce the ecosystem services. We know that the Indian Institute of Soil and Water Conservation, we do, our motive is that to conserve soil and also water and also the environment. Thereby, conserving the soil, that definitely we are announcing the ecosystem services, which provide each and everything. But again, probably because of COVID, we are not in a position to do it at the field level. I request Dr. Asmita sir and all my colleagues, at least during the next year, even let us start with even all the staff member of the institute or the regional station, whether it is possible to plant one plant in the research farm or any other kishan ka khet mein bhi karega to acha baat hai. To mark the occasion, एक गरीब का खेती में भी हम लोग एक एकर का प्लांटेशन भी करेंगे तो सो दैट इज द गुड द इनिशिएशन एंड टू सेलिब्रेट सो दैट वी कैन पुट दिस इज द वन बोर्ड आल्सो इट कैन बी पुट इन द सेंस टू सेलिब्रेशन हाफ द इको रिस्टोरेशन थीम particularly on 5th June 2021. In a similar way, I request particularly plant science division and those who are environmental scientists, the forestry and horticulture scientists, and also the environmental scientists to plan well in advance, because it is required well in advance. And apart from that, my dear friends, this particular day, it is being coincided with our monsoon starting. That is the beauty of it. Because in Kerala is already initiated and the monsoon, it is already approaching in Karnataka, Tamil Nadu and other parts. That means to say that the date is exactly coinciding with greening India, so that the environmental conservation point of view, I think that we can take it up. Under TSP and SESP also, there is a great potential to provide and also to distribution of some of the planting material, used to planting material on this occasion to mark the occasion. Because this, we are also coinciding with the 75 years of Azadi. What is that? Amrut Mahotsav hum log celebrate kar rahe hain. Government of India celebrate kar rahe hain. This is also one of the way so that we are contributing not only to environment, but also we are marking the 75 years of Amrut Mahotsav, where we are celebrating. With this, and also I thank the chief guest. He is available, he is on the line, or what, Dr. Mehta sir? He will be joining later, he is with us. Unmute current. Okay. Yeah. I have one presentation, just I would like to share, suppose if you don't mind it.
Please go ahead, sir.
It is visible.
Yes, sir. It is visible, sir.
Now it's okay.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Yeah, my dear friends, just I have few slides and a few points to share with you all. Just I am making. As you know, actually, these are the pan-India representation, what we do, the conservation and management of soil and water resources, including the vegetation resources, particularly in the agriculture land. That is our the ultimate vision. And my dear friends, as you know that the land degraded area in the world, it accounts about 15% of the total geographical area. In contrast to that, we have only 37%. Out of many degradation process, we have the water erosion is the cheaper one, that is at the global level and also the Indian continent. At the global level, it is 55%. Of course, Indian context, it is accounting about 68%. With respect to the sediment loss to the tune of 25 billion tons, and of course, we are losing, you see, we are losing about 20% it is contributed from the India, because we are contributing 5 billion tons and 25% is from the India alone. And of course, loss of food production, it accounts 9% at the global level, but Indian continent, we account about 16%. And apart from that, the offsite impact is that the reduction of the storage capacity of the reservoir to the extent of 1.2%, particularly from nearly 5,000 big dams. That is the major concern, the major ecosystem services actually which we are losing. And my dear friends, we know that the Havrai soil loss, it accounts about 15.6 tons per hectare. And as I told, we are losing in terms of monetary term nearly 29,000 crores of rupees. And in terms of nutrient, we are losing about 38,000 to 45,000 crores. Apart from that, particularly from the environmental point of view, we are losing 115 million tons of carbon, and also it is emitting nearly 35 million tons of carbon to the atmosphere. This is the status with respect to the land degradation, restoration, and on ecosystem services. Let us see the, my dear friends, cost of land degradation and land use change in India. It account, the economic cost, it is account about 16% gross value added from the agriculture and forestry. That means it accounts about 16% of the gross value of agriculture and forestry. And economic cost of land degradation, it account nearly 2.5% of the GDP, our GDP. And if you focus particularly on agriculture, it accounts about 0.6% of GDP of the agriculture. And almost about 82% of the estimated cost in account of land degradation, and only 18% due to the land use changes. That means to say that the majority, nearly 80%, more than 80%, it is from the land degradation, but hardly about 18 to 20% from the change in. The 14% of the total economic cost.
Yeah, I logged in.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Welcome, sir.
Professor sir, namaskar. I welcome you, Dr. Professor MNV Prasad sir from Hyderabad, for joining on this occasion on behalf of Indian Minister of Soil and Water Conservation, and on behalf of my colleagues and friends, those who have joined online, I welcome you, sir.
Welcome, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Thank you. My dear friends, actually, how the soil erosion contributing to the sustainable development goals, that directly, this soil erosion, it directly addressing to the major 7 sustainable development goals, that is end of poverty, zero hunger, clean water and sanitation, sustainable production, the climate change, and life on land. That means to say that the soil is the important component where it addresses many of the sustainable development goals and also the national missions in order to improve the ecosystem services. And let us talk about the cost of action and inaction. Suppose if at all we won't do any conservation measure, let us say that tomorrow Indian Institute of Soil and Water Conservation is closes. If say that actually it will be closed and all the scientists will be given voluntary retreatment, let us assume that, the what will be the impact? The cost of action for 6 years, it account about $161 million. But the cost of inaction is much more, my dear friend. The cost of inaction is 100% much more as compared to what cost of inaction. That means to say that we must have treating so many watersheds and other things, that is the cost of action. Due to that, that is the investment cost, what we are talking, $161 million. But the cost of inaction, if at all you are not doing that kind of treatment, definitely actually we are losing another 161 million US dollar. Totally put together, it will come nearly 300 million USD. But means to say that if you do not spend 1 rupee today, then we are losing 1.81 rupees tomorrow after 6 years. That is actually the meaning of nearly 2 rupees. If you are not spending today 1 rupee, after 6 years, we are losing another 1 rupee. That means totally 2 rupees we are losing. That is again, actually, they worked out for 30 years the cost of action and cost of inaction also. And after 30 years, actually, it says that actually 1 rupee today, it will become nearly 2 rupees 50 paise after 30 years. That is actually the cost of inaction. That's why this shows the importance of the conservation of precious resources, particularly the soil resources. And we are focusing our theme area also, our vision area also, the soil conservation to enhance the ecosystem services. My dear friends, actually, if you see the three-dimensional diagram here, my dear friend, if you see at the bottom, if you are starting from low to high, that means to say that the state of degradation, if you talk from right side to the left side, here you see top, actually it is a natural regeneration and followed by assisted natural regeneration. Suppose if it degraded, what will happen? Normally we do assisted natural regeneration. And then also we do the reforestation with native trees and other things. In the these actually more or less it is applicable for the reserve forest and other area. If you come to the private lands and other thing, commercial reforestation or agroforestry systems, it will come and followed by rehabilitation and reclamation. That means to say that the degradation process, actually if you starting from the forest area, public particularly the reserve forest area and other thing, the plantation area to the annual crop area, the degradation process will be much more higher. And then suppose if you talk about the left hand side, biodiversity and ecosystem services, it decreases. If you move from top to bottom, it decreases. That means if you move from the forest area to the annual crop area, the biodiversity and ecosystem services which we are losing, that means it decreases. And the right hand side also, the time taken to restore this, the degradation process, actually it will going to increases. The time and cost also it will going to decrease. That this particular slide is shows that, that means to say that whatever the environmental impact and other thing it is there, it is only from these kind of where we get our daily food, particularly from the agriculture land, that is contributing much more thing as compared to our natural forest. Of course, the natural forest actually they are enhancing much more ecosystem services. That's why actually we are neutralizing the process. This is the anthropological drive where in the environmental degradation it is taking place. It is start actually the misland use and soil management practice. Mismanagement of soil and land, non-availability of proper land management practices and crop management practices. What will happen actually, it is threatening, it is global warming, because as I already told also, it is emitting a lot of carbon to the atmosphere. That is one part. And also the secondly, what will happen, food insecurity it will come. The productivity it will come down, definitely food insecurity will be there. And the further depletion of soil degradation, it will be there, that it will be having an impact on human health. And put all together, it is affecting the hydrological cycle. And then actually it will ultimately lead to encroachment of your forest area and other thing, deforestation and misuse of land and other thing it will come, and diversion of land and other thing it will come for the other purpose. That is means to that actually the conversion of land from one, the land use to the another land use, definitely actually it is a serious issue, but it will be having a negative impact on the land use, ecosystem services. That's why, my dear friends, the country like India, it required the proper agriculture land use policy similar to the forest reserve forest policy. We don't have agriculture. We may say that I think Dubey sahab also we must have studied 143 million hectare when we have studied 30 years back. Our teacher must have told our not cultivated area is 141 or 143. But the thing now also we say that actually 141 million hectare. But the thing is, we are every year actually the so many people we are purchasing the land for house constructions and other thing, industrial area and other thing. From where that land comes from? Definitely it must have come from the agriculture land, not from the forest area. You mean to say that actually what we say that 141 or 142 million hectare, that figure has to be question mark and we have to reassess it. That's why I was mentioning that actually either state level or at the national level, there must be a policy for particularly for the agriculture land, non-conversion and other things. But it is there, but nobody is following. These are the degradation process, my dear friends. The process mechanism, that is erosion, salinization and other things that I think you are all know. The causing agents are climate, physiography, landform, socio-economic and ethnic problem, because shifting cultivated and other things, suppose if you come there, it will come. And other activity related to the deforestation, land use, land conversion and other things, extractive farming, that means intensive farming and other things. These are the some of the parameters actually it is lead to the soil degradation and the land degradation. And we have the restoration process through the conservation technology, reducing the loss of soil from particularly from the pedogen, from the top soil profile. Thereby we are restoring the services. Also the strengthening water and elemental cycling through the various agroforestry models and other things. Creating a positive soil carbon budget and enhancing biodiversity. These are the some of the things through which we are enhancing the restoration process of particularly land and the ecosystem services. My dear friends, actually we know that the soil is one of the prime natural resources. It provide the sustenance to everyone. It also provide the ecosystem services. Suppose if at all we wanted to have a forest, if at all we wanted to have any other thing, definitely we are using the soil as the base material. Suppose if at all we wanted to water harvesting, we talk about, there also we talk about the soil profile research in order to increase the subsurface flow. That means to say that, my dear friends, without soil, actually you cannot talk about the ecosystem services. That's why the important parameter like soil organic carbon, particularly sand, silt, and these are the brothers, and other physical and chemical properties and other things, it is associated with the soil, that play a major important role. That means to say that the entire globe, the entire world, actually it is revolving under stable aggregates. We are all agriculture stream. Since we are talking about the agriculture background, the stable aggregate is the much more revolving component play a major role. Suppose if at all your soil health is good, that means to say that actually the indicator is the stable aggregates. How stable aggregate? The stable aggregates indirectly reflecting the presence of organic matter and organic carbon. That means to say that actually your bio, microflora and fauna and everything, it is good. If the soil properties, particularly physical and biological properties are good, definitely the stable aggregates and other things, it will improve organic carbon and other things, it will go to improve. Thereby, it can enhance the ecosystem services. My dear friends, actually, there are four ecosystem services. One is provisioning. That means to say that actually what we, the food class and other things, we also got the cultural aspect related to that, and regulating mechanisms. The regulating mechanism like atmosphere regulation and soil, the soil formation and other thing. The supporting mechanism like the nutrient recycling and other thing. The my dear friends, the supporting and regulating mechanism, we cannot do anything. We cannot alter it. But what we are doing is that through actually what we are doing, actually we are managing the supporting and regulating services in order to enhance the provisioning and cultural service. Either we talk about the watershed management practices or any other restoration management practices. Through the management practices, we are enhancing the regulating and supporting services that in turn contribute to the tangible and intangible benefits. And thereby we are getting the reasonable provisional and cultural services. Suppose our services become poor management practices, what will going to happen? This is going to affect the mainly provisional and cultural services. It will going to affect. That means to say that, my dear friend, so our watershed management program or any silent water conservation measure, we are enhancing the regulating services and supporting services. Thereby, we are harvesting provisioning and cultural services. This is the basic funda of the ecosystem services. And my dear friends, actually, I tried to list out our conservation measures here under four categories, that is provisioning, regulatory services, and supporting services and cultural services. We have agronomic measures, vegetative barriers, engineering measures, DLTs, agroforestry, plantation, and other things, water resource development. These are the some of the indicating that these are the degree of the contribution of different silent water conservation measures, different silent water conservation measures for the various types of services, ecosystem services. That means to say that the degree it varies, but any measures, if you take any silent water conservation or any technology what we are advocating, all the technology actually embedded in this ecosystem services. That is the point I wanted to make. That's all. These are the benefits of ecological benefits of soil conservation. That means enhancing the hydrological cycle, nutrient cycle, soil quality, and climate change. That means we are enhancing the resilience to the climate change and other things. I think this you must have gone already. I think this I am not taking much time. My dear friends, actually, we have made an estimate, right, to the ecosystem services of different conservation measures. Suppose here the no bunding, no conservation measure. Here actually we have taken the field bunding, stone bunding plus broom grass, earthen bed plus broom grass, with iris cropping, strip cropping, intercropping, sambuta as a vegetative barrier, and agroforestry, meaning mango plus Niger. These are the some of the component actually we have taken. Actually, we did it at Korapur. We have started exercising. You see that actually the ecosystem services in terms of ecosystem services in terms of number of times actually it is enhanced. Compared to no bunding, actually ecosystem services enhanced to the extent of 11.3% in case of a field bunding. Soil loss by 3.1%, actually reduced by soil loss to the extent by 3.1 times. That means to say that most of all the soil conservation measures it is having a ecosystem services which we have analyzed. And this is the bamboo forestry with respect to what. In this particular slide, actually, they have taken the different ecosystem services and they compared the natural bamboo forest with the natural forest, degraded forest, planted forest, grassland, and agriculture land. My dear friends, actually, if you come down here under natural forest, the forest plantation, that means bamboo plantation is much more, 55%. 55% is much more providing ecosystem services as compared to the natural forest. If you come to the degraded forest, the bamboo plantation, it is providing 85% more better than the degraded forest. in the similarly planted forest, the 75% more. In case of a grassland, it is 80% more. And in case of a agriculture land, it is 90% more. It is the comparison of bamboo plantation with different land uses, particularly the natural forest and degraded forest and agriculture land. That means to say that each and every species, they are having a potential to provide the ecosystem service. My dear friends, actually, this is an indicative slide where the shifting cultivation, it was there. We tried to assess that actually the ecosystem services value of the shifting cultivated. What they will do, the shifting cultivated, you know that they will cut up the original natural forest. Where what will happen, actually, the current shifting cultivation, they will cut and burn and they will do it. It will go minus to the extent, because actually if you calculate it in terms of emission. If you calculate and put it, it accounts, actually it will account 9,360,000 per hectare per year, that is annual. And also we have abandoned shifting cultivated fallow. It is not a cultivated fallow, it is an abandoned one. They are not cultivating. For the restoration purpose, actually they left it. There it accounted 5.63 and 9.75 and about nearly 12,000 per hectare per year. That means to say that actually this is the scenario where we keep the land in restoration process, that definitely ecosystem services point of view, actually that it will go to increase. My dear friends, actually we do a lot more with respect to the watershed management practices. This is the one where with watershed management practices, we are increasing almost all the things. The regulatory services, recreational services, supporting services and provisioning services. And it means to say that the total ecosystem services through the many TSP activity, it is oriented toward the land, soil improvement, land improvement, agroforestry and other things. Those components definitely actually it is contributing to the total increasing, the enhancing the ecosystem services. Suppose where I was mentioning the cost of action, my dear friends, actually this is the cost of action. The amount which we are spending toward the watershed management program, we get here. If the cost of inaction means if you are not treating the watershed, if at all we are not taking any soil and water conservation measures, the state it will be like this, it will going to decrease. That means to say that my emphasis is that the management program actually it is a important, particularly the crop and soil and land management practices are very, very important to enhance the ecosystem services, because it supports other services. Suppose it reduces the runoff, means actually it increases the groundwater, it increases the soil moisture profile. Once increase the soil moisture content, microflora, microfauna and other things going to increase. It also increases the vegetation and other things. There it is increasing the soil carbon and the above and below ground biomass and other things. In the similar way, and perennity of the water, it will going to increase. Availability of water, it will going to increase. Thereby, the your ecosystem services, it will increase. But only thing is, actually, we have to look the upstream and downstream linkages, that is in a question mark, because still we are unable to address it. This is my last, my dear friends. The thing is, actually, we say that the earth does not belong to us. We belong to earth. That is actually the scenario we have to take it. And we have to feel that actually this earth or particularly soil or land, with due respect, it has to be handed over to the next generation. That is my humble request. On this occasion, actually, I thank Dr. Harsh Mehta ji and also my senior colleague and Professor M.N.V. Prasad ji as a chief speaker on this occasion. I thank for giving an opportunity to share some of my view on this occasion. In next year, we would like to celebrate, we would like to mark this occasion in a different way. I request both and our scientific colleagues, head of the centers and our colleague, let us initiate something new, some new idea to mark this occasion. With this, मैं सबको धन्यवाद करता हूँ, नमस्कार करता हूँ. Not only the environment what we are talking, our working environment also need to be enhanced. Let us focus about both on working environment, either the center environment or the institute environment, that also need to be enhanced, and our family environment also to be enhanced, and thereby we can also contribute to the environmental enhancing the ecosystem services of the environment. With this, dhanyawad. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. In fact, we are very much impressed by your excellent talk and the solution for enhancing ecosystem services. In fact, your talk has been a very illuminating one, in which you have talked about the present status and what should be done in the future next 10 to 20 years. Now, I take this opportunity for the keynote address by our MNV Park. So that he's the emeritus scientist, University of Hyderabad. We are very eager to listen to you, sir. And before that, I would ask Dr. Anand Kumar Gupta to state and mention speaker.
Thank you, Dr. Harsh Mehta sir, for giving me an opportunity to introduce our today's speaker, Dr. Majeti Narasimha Vara Prasad. Dr. MNV Prasad sir is currently working as Emeritus Professor, School of Life Sciences, University of Hyderabad. He was formerly Dean of School of Life Sciences, formerly Head Department of Plant Sciences, formerly Coordinator of Biotechnology Program, formerly coordinator of PG Diploma in Environmental Education and Management from the University of Hyderabad. Sir has did his MSc from Andhra University. Sir did his PhD from University of Lucknow from 1975 to 1979. He conducted his research at Birbal Sahani Institute of Paleosciences. It is an autonomous institute under the Department of Science and Technology, Government of India. Sir worked as lecturer from June 1980 to 85 at Department of Botany at Northeastern Hill University, Shillong. And after that, sir joined as associate professor at the University of Hyderabad School of Life Sciences in 1990. And sir, from then, sir is working as head and at different positions at University of Hyderabad. Sir has made significant contributions in the field of plant metal interaction, bioremediation and bioeconomy. Sir has published 221 research articles in peer reviewed journals and 141 book chapters. Sir has published 34 books, including 15 in Elsevier, 6 in John Ville, 6 in Springer, 1 each in Russian and different academy. And I am happy to share you, sir has the H index of 69. And sir, today I checked the citation of sir, it is 20,968. Even based on the data compiled and studied by John Loandis of Stanford University elsewhere and SciTech strategies and published in a high respected journal PLOS ONE, it was published in 2020 and sir, MNV Prasad ranked first in India and 116th at global level in the field of environmental sciences. And sir has different global assignments at various universities and sir is the visiting professor of more than 16 countries. including Canada, Poland, Portugal, Sweden, Finland, Australia, Kazakhstan, Russia, Belgium, Thailand, Brazil. And sir has published his research papers in more than 67 peer-reviewed journals. Sir has guided 14 PhD and 7 MPhil students. So with this small introduction, I can say only it is a small introduction. Actually, sir has sent me 34 pages of his biodata, but due to lack of time, I just introduced in just small time. So thank you, sir. Thank you for inviting. Thank you for accepting our invitation. So I welcome you, sir, from the Indian Institute of Soil and Water Conservation. So, sir, please, we are eager to listen you, sir.
Good morning. Can you hear me? Hello?
Yes, sir. You are audible.
Very much audible, sir.
Yeah, and screen also visible?
Yes, sir, it is visible, sir.
Okay, good morning. First of all, it was an excellent talk by Dr. Madhu, director of the institute. I thank the organizing team, Dr. Anand Kumar and Dr. Harsh Mehta, and Lord Dr. Pankaj Srivastava and so on. I dedicate this talk to late Sundarlal Bhauguna, who is the doyen of environment in Uttarakhand, who initiated the Chipko movement, and Government of India recognized. I know in the 80s and 75, Chipko movement in Uttarakhand was attracted the global attention. So this talk is in honor of this great scientist, environmentalist. We already had one talk about ecosystem services by the director, Dr. Madhu, and it was highly illuminating. This year's environmental theme is ecosystem restoration. And all of you know that the UNEP, by consultative mechanisms, select a particular theme. Now, if you read, I don't want to read all these things because there are time constraints and so on. None of these themes have been addressed by the scientific community. We are carrying every year one particular aspect, and it is a load. For example, this year has been ecosystem restoration, World Environment Day. The previous years, if you see, beat air pollution, beat plastic pollution, and so on and so forth. But the important reference I would like to make in connection with ecosystem restoration is the paper published in 2020 June, Ethology, by a great Max Planck Institute scientist from Germany, about the pandemic, current pandemic, corona. He attributed that this corona outbreak is because of climate change and the biodiversity loss. So I feel that ecosystem restoration is an important subject. We must understand the ecosystem services, both air, water, soil, and the institute is Indian Institute of Soil and Water Conservation. Fundamentally, any ecosystem, whether it is a lake or agriculture or an urban, these are the basic functions, MSc students' point of view, like or a beginners of environmental science, food chain, food web, nutrient cycling, energy flow, development and devolution, and self-regulation. But what we are now focused is ecosystem restoration. Say, for example, a original ecosystem is exploited, it is degraded. That we take several steps and we grade them, you know, it is replaced, what we call reclamation or rehabilitation or restoration, also remediation. Say, for example, aquatic body is polluted by industrial pollutants, or an urban ecosystem is polluted, we try to address the problems of pollution through the biotic component, and by understanding the interactions, and that is what is the remediation. So the ecological management of the ecosystem by scientific and engineering principles play a crucial role for ecosystem restoration. Here, in this slide, this is a degraded system where you see the mine waste, nothing grows. This is another site, red mud, which is a byproduct of an industry, aluminium industry, nothing grows. On the soil, the pH is 11 plus. So the, you all know the physiological pH is 5.7. But then the these four frames, you see certain plants are growing happily. They are able to grow there. There is no fertile soil and the moisture content is very low. So why certain plants adapt themselves to certain degraded ecosystems, certain contaminated sites, polluted sites, where there are no nutrients and so on? That is the main crux. If we can find answers, probably we will be able to implement on a large scale ecological restoration projects. Now there are numerous contaminants and pollutants you take. Just now Dr. Madhu spoke elaborately about agriculture, agriculture sector, agroecosystems, urban systems, rural systems, forest systems. None of them are, what is this going on? Hello, hello. So these are polluted, and then there are enormous emerging contaminants. I will not go into the emerging contaminants, electronic waste and toxic substances and so on. But it was also mentioned in the previous talk, the Sustainable Development Goals and so on. Ecological restoration is the backbone for sustainable development goals. Let us say, for example, goal number 13, 14 talks about biodiversity and climate change. And goal number 6, clean water. So how we achieve the cleanup, restoration? It is because of numerous processes taking place, and biological diversity is the tool for achieving ecological eco-restoration. Let us take a photo autotroph. You see, there is no soil if there is no rock. If there is no soil, there is no plant. So from rocks to soil formation takes place. And from soils, plants will survive. And there are different groups of plants, and their physiology and genetics all play a major role. And plants are the convenient tools, particularly in cleanup of many of these contaminants, the what is called emerging pollutants, contaminants. There are several processes. I'm not going into the details at cellular level, at membrane level, in transport of these contaminants. Because organic contaminant and pollutants, they can be degraded, but the inorganics cannot be degraded. So they have to be rendered less toxic by complexing by the cells of the plants. Now, I have some exposure in different parts, particularly the mine waste point of view. There are different types of mines, because the DST has sponsored 4 international projects, 2 with Poland and 1 with Portugal and Thailand. Now, what happens if we are near a mine site? See, mining is very essential. India has about 60 different minerals, coal mines, but mining activity and mine-based, mineral-based industries cause pollution, air pollution, pollution to the heritage, and the loss of biodiversity and so on. So these are all to be addressed in a theme like ecological restoration. The most ancient example of a metal tolerant plant was published in 1588 by Thalias. That is Minuartia. Now in India, the mining activity is centuries old. So we have gold coins, we have different type of, the statues like Nataraja, dancing Nataraja statue and daggers, ammunition and so on. So metallurgy is a very old science in India, well known. Metallurgy including the nanoparticle synthesis like Swarna Basma, Tamra Basma and so on. Now, plants can interact with these toxic metal ions. For example, you can see here, they take up the toxic metals and exclude them. Don't allow them to translocate to the aerial part of the harvestable part of the plant. They are excluders. Or they take up, but then they are compartmentalized. That is what is called in both indicators and accumulators. They accumulate, but the only difference between indicator and accumulator is both have toxic metals. Here they show some symptoms, toxic visible symptoms. Probably when we deal with the plant metal interactions, we develop certain interest, and then we can detect these are the plants that are exposed to toxic metals and so on. And in this case, you can see certain plants, they are endemics. They are able to take large quantity of metals like water, because the plants are fixed to the substratum. They cannot run away like animals. So if a metal is present in the substratum, if they are taken up, either they have died or they have to develop certain adaptations. So here example is an endemic plant. You can see the bluish green tinge is because of nickel sulfate. And in this case, the sap has green color. It is this solution has a metal content. But these are endemics. They grow in certain pockets only, but there are now technologies coming up. Here is a professor from US, he developed a technology called phytomining technology. That means there are certain plants that accumulate metals, they are used, and they're also genetically engineered. And he developed a technology, phytomining technology extraction. So this is followed in certain nickel mines, and also there are papers in Nature. We can harvest gold from the plants. We can harvest platinum. For example, there are some students who have done some experiments with cancer patients treated with cisplatin drugs, and the urine from the hospital, it's exclusively cancer patients treated with cisplatin. Urine is collected, and from urine, platinum is recovered. So it is possible that technology has made us to learn these things, extraction of toxic metals and so on, use them. Now in Telangana state, we have mines in Kottagudem and so on. For example, this is the mine site, extracted coal, but then the residue is discarded. How to restore the ecological restoration, or we may call eco-restoration. We need to know about local flora and collect seedlings and plant them. So it takes a long time. Similarly, the major mineral resources in India are located in the central part of the India, particularly Jharkhand state is very rich. Other states also have South India, Tamil Nadu has lignite. And there are a lot of mine waste generated from these, and they have to be restored. Say, for example, if we take a cross section of a coal mine, this is a thin layer of coal beneath the soil. But below and above, there is a lot of soil deposit. So in order to extract this coal seam, we have to disturb this with heavy machinery and discard. What is happening is now we don't pay attention to the topsoil or overburden, but we are interested in extracting the economically important material. And then the waste is discarded here because it doesn't have fuel, coal. And this has to be restored, failing which during rainy season, erosion and nearby water bodies are polluted, groundwater is polluted. So there are certain plants, local species, early succession, late succession plants. Say, for example, there are grasses here, there are certain dicots, they grow there. The other problem of mining is also the waste forms. In fact, there has sulfide minerals and so on, forms acid mine. Acid mine is also, the water cannot be used for domestic purpose. So on a mine waste, one of the students did some work, the Morus alba can be cultivated, and Morus alba is a feed for silkworm, and silk is a very expensive material. Today we know the sarees cost more than a lakh. If you go and want to buy a Chennai silk saree, you need to have a very bulgy pocket of money. And there are many economic aspects from these waste we can recover resource. Another example is vetiver jejunoides. In other words, this is called the chrysopogon. Chrysopogon jejunoides. This is an excellent soil binder. Root stock is very robust. You can see the roots, they grow to length of 6 to 8 feet. And in all tropical countries, this is a boon to stabilize the mine slopes. And what we call cuscus grass. Normally the windows and during summer season, this is used as a rooftop for taxis and so on. So cuscus distilled oil is important for floor cleaning and so on. The Neyveli is one of the important mine in India, where it produces electricity, national grid. It is one of the major contributor for electricity production. Now in Neyveli, the German technology is followed, wheel and bucket. So they extract the lignite. So lignite is sent to the power plant, but the topsoil is collected and preserved. This is the topsoil fertile, and this topsoil is used for restoration programs, where you see here legumes and non-legumes and grasses are cultivated on the mine waste, mine overburden. Also certain energy plants and some economically important plants like Jetropha carcass. Jetropha carcass for fuel point of view, it is a failure, but then it helps in many cosmetic industries. Oil, seed oil is important. So the success of ecological restoration depends on how strong we can develop a nursery of different native plant species. For example, the grasses, the legumes and trees are important. For example, the solid boxes represent for tropical countries examples, and hollow boxes to the temperate. Fescuca sativa, you know, this is the grass which is very important, $1 billion business on tennis courts. You know, we have a tennis open world champions and so on, for example, Wimbledon. Now, those courts are maintained with grass. And today, even in cities like Hyderabad and all, artificial turf grass polo grounds are developed without soil and with polluted water. It is possible. So the grasses play a major role. And understanding the soil leachate and soil leachate physicochemistry and what pollutants, how the solute soil interactions. Lysimeters are used. For example, the lysimeter is a technique where it analyzes the soil plant atmosphere interactions through instruments. Now you can see here the man with the orange t-shirt, Ralph Meisner. He is a world famous soil physicist. He manages a lysimeter station, this guy is his student, John Rinkelbe, and we have some collaboration for lysimeter applications in water and soil conditions, including flood plains. They have a river and so on. So he worked in Wuppertal University. He worked in Falkenberg glycimeter station. And Wuppertal is very popular for this kind of transport. You know, they have made a transport above the drainage system. So they don't use the other area. Wherever the drainage flows, there is a transport. Probably in Chennai, they have followed the similar system. So the glycimeter station you can see here, this is the glycimeter station. And underground, you have all these connected with the tubes. The leachate is collected here for long-term experiments. You apply fertilizers, there is a floodplain, there are urban floods. What type of pollutants, contaminants are deposited in the urban flood after urban floods, where they are deposited, what is the source, and to identify all these mechanisms. This kind of instruments play a major role. So this requires a lot of instrumentation, sensors, and automation. So it gets down, and then this is the underground glycimeter station collecting. Each one comes from a particular source for experiments and so on. In India, we are not shortage of water. We have hundreds of rivers, hundreds of lakes and water bodies. You see here all these black circles on this map are Ramsar sites. Ramsar is a city in Iran with an international convention declaration. We are a signatory to the Ramsar site, so we have recognized. These are all protected by environmental laws. And this is one lake in northeast, Loktak Lake. And the speciality of this Loktak Lake is that the macrophytes in the lake forms into circular discs type things. These are called fundis. And the people live there. They make this, they live there. They are called atafum because these people fish and they get a lot of materials from these islands. These are floating islands, fundis. One student did PhD on this. So we had an extensive investigations, fisheries and so on. So these had, they live there. And this is also very important for hydrogeology point of view, for electricity, it's in the Imphal. So it's a Ramsar site. Like that, we have in Andhra Pradesh, Kulleru Lake. We have in Tamil Nadu, Kerala has three Ramsar sites and so on. Plenty of rivers we have, but then the paradox is that we have water shortage. The wetlands are complicated systems, chemical factories. In India, we think wetland means is a receptacle for industrial waste, is a receptacle for domestic waste. But there is a carrying capacity for of these things. So there are so many macrophytes. You can see, you know, red and white lilies, etc. They are the players in cleaning up the unwanted materials from these water bodies. This is the cross section of a water body. You have floating plants, you have rooted plants, you have emergent plants, and so on. Many of these plants, they may take up volatile components from the water and also from the sediments and release into the atmosphere, release the bioavailability to the cattle and human being. So there are many other microbiological processes also take place in the wetland systems. And this guy goes with a cylinder, oxygen cylinder, diver to 30 meters, 40 meters below the lake and brings the rooted macrophytes. That was the project I handled in University of Quebec, INRSO. There are certain macrophytes, for example, Vallisneria americana, the plant leaf can grow 30 to 40 meters. In India, Vallisneria spiralis also, the leaf is long, two meters to 3 meters it grows. And they accelerate sedimentation process in the polluted water bodies and also take up toxic metals. So mostly I studied there the metal budgeting of these macrophytes from the lakes and rivers there in near Montreal. There are large macrophytes. All of you have seen this, like water hyacinth, water lettuce, and so on. So the biomass productivity is very high. Without any inputs, they grow in polluted water, they take up, they survive. But we need to know the science of management and apply them for environmental restoration, particularly water bodies. The wastewater can be treated by horizontal flow and vertical flow using macrophytes, specific macrophytes. These macrophytes have to be managed very scientifically, otherwise they can become nuisance and then they will, many of them may be invasive. Now biological control technology is also possible. In India, Karnal, a town in Haryana, has developed a practice, that's what's called Karnal technology, where the sewage water is stored in these ridges and furrows tanks, is a kind of a cascade system follow. They encourage the microbial consortia, plus also artificially gravel, limestone, and so on to buffer the chemical reactions and treat the water and let off the water for irrigation purpose on this site. So this process of treatment of water with macrophytes is Karnal technology. It is popular and developed in Karnal. Industrial wastewaters are also treated by macrophytes. For example, in Odisha, there is a national aluminium company, Asia's largest smelter. So the waste coming from the smelter and washouts, slurry, is released into the wetland. And you can see these macrophytes, high biomass producing macrophytes, typha and phragmites, Eichhornia crispus. And water is treated. Treated water from the wetlands is sent back. This is the boat they use for monitoring duckweeds and macrophytes. And the water from these ponds is sent back to the industry for cooling towers, returned to the industry. Also, they have a power plant. They have a captive power plant. Therefore, they require a lot of water. And this wastewater is coming from the ash unit and so on. Well, water hyacinth has certain beneficial functions. Like, for example, this plant can be used in industries where the cyanide is released. This has an enzyme, so the beta cyanoalanine synthase that degrades the cyanide. When we think of gold industry always produces cyanide because there is a cyanide, ammonium thiocyanate is used as a leaching agent. So invariably cyanide is the waste in the wastewaters, so which is very toxic. And the other macrophytes, these are small miniature macrophytes. It looks like a cabbage leaves water lettuce. That's why it is called water lettuce. Very convenient. They are not rooted plants. They are free floating. This is a fish pond with a luxuriant growth of, you don't see water at all. Fish pond with luxuriant growth of Fistia stratioides. After one crop with this boat, they remove, they harvest. And then this accumulates toxic metals, and these are all certain figures, cadmium and lead. Particularly, see, in Indian system, tropical water bodies, the problem is in summer season, they get dried up. For many places, the water is dried up, or very small quantity of water. Even our perennial rivers are getting dried up. Now, due to urban floods, all the washout from the urban systems washed out and they are stored here. So they bring about toxic materials and the water has this. And if we use those water bodies for fish culture through fish, again, through food chain, this toxic material participate in the food chain. Therefore, those have to be cleaned with low cost methodologies like water lettuce. Now, this is after harvesting the water lettuce. From this end to the other end, there are zigzag where they tie ropes, and the small patches that you see here, these are all the packets of food, nutrient material for fish. And then they are immersed, half immersed in the water, and prawn seedlings and fish seedlings are released into the water. And then the food produced from such a cleanup water is safer. So this is the service of the water lettuce. Likewise, there are other examples, ornamentals from Indian scenario, like Canna indica. It has different variants, colored materials. It's useful particularly for fluoride removal, hedges, dyes, and nutrients, and also for production of biochar and so on. So this is one of the important material in our scenario. And then there are miniature plants called duck weeds, because the duck grazes these weeds, and high biomass produced in Typha latifolia, Phragmites, and they are all highly useful for treatment of wastewaters. We have to develop and we have to understand the efficient way of managing these macrophytes. This is the Typha, for example. If the water is only nutrients and sewage water, the biomass produced by the macrophytes can be harvested, can be used in the villages. Poor people use bamboos and this kind of leaves for roofing, or they can be crushed into compost. So in Europe, some countries they convert this into biofertilizer and use for ornamental plants. Another example of water pure treatment, probably in agriculture, rice paddies. For example, we have two species of Azolla. It is a water fern. One species is Azolla coralliana with anthocyanin pigments. It is very simple. In 2 months, farmers can do on their own. Here they are cultivating and then use for rice paddies. So this is a rice paddy with Azolla fertilizer, biofertilizer. We have the paper on cadmium minimization in rice review, and a student also did a PhD on this. The source for cadmium in rice is phosphate fertilizers. Without applying phosphate fertilizers, yield will be very low. So we use different fertilizers. So invariably every year, we keep on enriching the rice paddy's cadmium level. So we have to clean failing which we consume cadmium. There are numerous techniques and environmental tools globally now. The industry is growing because this is World Environment Day, eco restoration. Lot of industrial houses are doing surveys along with the natural ecosystems, ecosystem surveys. See the growth of the industry from 1970. This is with reference to US. And by 2020, so many folds growth in various sectors, in air quality, waste management, water equipment, remediation, hazardous waste management, and so on and so forth. More recently, in India, the IoT, that is Internet of Things, is very popular. At least I give some states in India. For example, Tamil Nadu state, the Pollution Control Board, last 2 to 3 years, they are monitoring the industrial emissions, real-time monitoring by IoT. It is machine to machine or Skynet, etc. There are so many other technologies deployed in the environmental restoration, starting with drones to robotics to satellite technology. For example, the data that we got, pandemics, all the nitrogen, sulfur oxides, particulate material, and so on, in a short time, it was possible only because of the satellites. And then these are the industries. You see the percentage of involvement in environmental cleanup. IoT, for example, IoT is here. Today, is a simple tool. Almost every instrument we buy, we have the microprocessors, and it can be connected to the smartphones, and people can monitor. The environmental monitoring has become very handy and convenient. An example, particularly for irrigation system, farmers in the past, farmers were facing numerous problems, go at odd times, different times, irrigation. Today we have sensors, near infrared based sensors, detect the soil moisture. If the soil moisture is below certain level or no moisture, then automatically it sends Raspberry Pi sends a signal to the motor, and motor will switch on. And the soil becomes saturated with water, the motor stops. And the electricity comes from the solar panel. So everything is standalone systems. And this is very important for management of the water footprint in agriculture. See, goal number 6 and goal number 12 are related for this kind of environmental management. So all the advanced technologies of IoT and computer-based information mm-hmm. is playing a major role today in the environmental management and so on. I give an example of a success story of one of the startup. It's called BioStart Ventures with a Netherlands collaboration. What they do is they make a floating islands for cleanup of the lakes. So these are all the floats, and these are all the plants that I talked before, like Kenna and other macrophytes, high biomass producing macrophytes. For example, this is the float and have sensors, and whatever grass, whatever can be grown in water, what floats and grasses and so on, and monitor the treatment processes. These are the simple tools. Even in aquaculture ponds, these tools can be followed. So IoT-based environmental management, particularly for remediation and restorations, this is coming up. This is a lake from Hyderabad, beautiful scenery. You have here the hotels and secretariat and so on. But this huge lake has no utility. For domestic purpose, we can't use this water for domestic purpose. So in the year 2009, there was a global tender cleanup. So the reason is lot of the pharmaceutical industries and other industrial waste from Patancheru and all other, Hyderabad has industries on all four corners. Mm-hmm. The waste is discharged into the lake, Hussain Sagar Lake, and sediments are polluted. So, but it could not be implemented because of cost and so on. It is, the process is scientifically, people have not done the HDMA. You see, it's not only the cleaning up in one time, but subsequent to cleaning, we need to monitor. So we need to have a trained manpower for management, failing which we clean one season, next season it will be come to the original state because everything. So unless all these are plugged, it is not possible to maintain. So once again, the interest was revived by another chief minister saying in the year 2030, it will be cleaned again. But you see, the problems are several. There are so many issues which is difficult to discuss in this seminar. Every year for Ganesh Vimarjan, large quantity of Ganesh idols, which have lead-based paints and metallic paints and so on, they are all immersed in Hussain Sagar. That is one source. And then the sediments of the lake are very rich in metals. Therefore, we have to clean the sediments, and we have to clean the water, and we have to maintain. That's the issue. There is another lake, it's called Noor Mohammed Kunta near Shamshabad Airport way. This has attracted a World Bank grant, World Bank assistance under a particular scheme. You know, the project was handled by a Netherlands company, Wittenbois. And in turn, Wittenbois got the contract, and they gave to a Ahmedabad-based Kadam Industries. This is what I learned from abroad. So they operated. It's the same story. They cleaned it, they beautified it, but after 2 years, it comes to the original status. So the other aspects are air pollution. It's air, water, soil. All the three compartments are very essential for comfortable living. Today, urban pollution is a serious problem, and air pollution, air quality in many cities is very poor, including capitals. So the culprit we call climate change is the problem. But in climate change also, there are numerous industries are coming up for carbon capture, for green buildings, for transportation, for resilience, and so on. For example, the tree bark can be used for monitoring the what type of emissions are there. There was a paper in Nature, they used the trees at the site of warfare. Say, for example, there are so many wars, Europe and in Middle East, etc. Now, what type of chemical weapons if they have used? Now, those can be detected by sampling the tree bark and the depositions. And with accurate data, it is reliable. And then also naturally, these are all the nature cure trees have different canopies, different type of leaves, different type of margins and phyllotaxy. All these things are important and they filter the air. So these are all the, what is called living walls and there are many projects. But the most important discovery was that there are certain endophytes sitting in the tissue, in the mesophyll tissue of the leaves, both fungi and bacteria. These are the mesophytes which degrade the toxic gases in the atmosphere, endophytes. For example, the leaf tissue, and you have particulate material, sulfur dioxide, BTX, NOx, and so on, volatile organic formaldehyde, et cetera, from industrial source, et cetera. All these gases in the mesophyll tissue, in the endophytes, the fungi and bacteria, they convert these things into beneficial nutrients. They convert, say for example, here NOx converted into nitrates and so on, some of the organic ones. So this is the way we need to understand the type of plants that are required as a green belt for a particular industry. For example, there is a paint industry, there is a other industry, we need to understand those things. Now, air quality monitoring is also becoming highly sophisticated even at a domestic sector. You can see this is the cross section. You have toilets here, drinking water, kitchen, and living rooms, and so on. We have so many chemicals. We use chlorine and chlorinated compounds. We use perfumes. We use flame retardant materials, paints, and carpets, and the sofas. Many of them have fire retardant materials, chemicals, pesticides for disinfection we use. So we are exposed to the chemicals. For this, for monitoring, automated softwares, automated wristbands are developed. What you have, smart watch system. It will monitor your health also. So it is a business now. There are hundreds of chemicals that can be detected with a simple wrist watch. For $40 to $500, you can buy the sophisticated wrist smart watches. This is the one which has memory for 1,000 chemicals it can detect. And I have to thank Jeremy here. He spent 9 months as a Fulbright scholar. We were going around the Tamil Nadu, chromium, leather tanneries, and so on. And after returning to US, he concentrated on environmental health and the wristband work was mostly his examples. So we need to know what are our strengths and in terms of progressing, in terms of developing these tools. Today, I know many of you are wearing the smart watches. And also one of the sustainable development goal is smart city. See, India is planning, we are ambitious. We want to develop a smart city, 100 smart cities in India. I don't know how long it will take. And sometimes I wonder what is this concept of a smart city. So smart city, smart hospital, smart highway system, smart factories, and so on. If we have to do this type of things, we need to depend upon IoTs and highly sophisticated sensors and so on. Then it is possible. We have some of these already. Say, for example, you want to go to airport. Now you don't call to a company by land phone and so on. Today we have mobiles. On the mobile, you have all radio taxis, etc. Communication, everything is normal. Similarly, at the domestic sector, house locking system, irrigation system, pipeline gas system, everything is monitored in many countries, many cities, some places. So say, for example, go to Gurgaon, is a highly efficiently managed IT town. So for atmospheric gases, probably some kind of plants like this, native plant, Ricinus communis. The advantage of this plant is it has a large lamina, more than 1 foot. This is 12 inches. So 18 inches diameter. So they have the ability to trap the particulate material and they have the ability to grow on polluted sites and analysis and so on, and they help in restorations of the industrial contaminated sites in Periyarban, Hyderabad. This was a paper in Environmental Science Pollution. Thank you very much. This is a beautiful tree on the campus of the University of Hyderabad, a bignoniaceae. It flowers only 1 month in winter. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. In fact, we are very much overwhelmed by this talk. In fact, we are extremely thankful to for his topic on ecosystem restoration, recent trends in technology for sustainable development. In fact, you have made very valid points towards bioengineering and the phytoremediation. In fact, these are the immediate concerns of our new agriculture, because agriculture of today and tomorrow is no more the same as it was before. So therefore, the environment sciences, they have to take a very positive role in carrying forward our agricultural research. And with your talk, we have been very much overwhelmed in a way that you have given us the direction as to how the things should go in future. In fact, Dr. Prasad is a very busy person. In fact, at a very short notice, he agreed to deliver this talk. And we are very much thankful to you, sir. And I think that we'll be getting some other opportunities to interact with you, sir. And I think that with all the 58 participants who have attended this webinar, I think they will agree with me. And before I close, I will invite Dr. A.C. Rathore to say the formal vote of thanks. Dr. Rathore, please.
Thank you, sir. First of all, I will propose my sincere vote of thanks to Dr. M.N.B. Prasad, who has many achievements in his life, as pointed out by Mr. Anand Kumar Gupta. Presently, he is working as Emeritus Professor, School of Life Sciences, University of Hyderabad, Telangana, India. And he has accepted our invitation within a short notice. Besides other assignments, sir, we are very thankful to you. And we have been enlightened with your presentations, ecosystem restorations, recent trends in technology for sustainable development. This will help in restoring our environment. Today's present context, it is very much important to protect our environment, as nowadays we are facing a global challenge in the form of virus. It is a product of gene, environment and genetics interactions. So in this present context, it is a duty of each and every individual of this planet to work hard to restore our environment. Otherwise, life is not so easy. Nature anytime can take even serious effect on us. So I also thank to our director, IISWC, Dr. M. Madhu sir, for sharing his views for land restorations for enhancing ecosystem services. It is also related to our protection of environment in the light of World Environment Day. Thank you, sir. And thanks are also due to our senior colleagues. I could see in our webinar, Dr. R.S. Yadav sir, Dr. Harsh Mehta sir, Dr. S.K. Dubey sir, Dr. Bhake Bihari sir, Dr. Charan Singh sir, Dr. Kannan from Uti, and many seniors, colleagues, I pay my thanks to all for patient sharing of both the speakers presented topics related to Environment Day. And I also thank to organizing team of Plant Science Division led by Dr. Harsh Mehta sir, and Dr. Charan Singh sir, and Anand Kumar Gupta. I also thank to Amit Chavanji, who hosted this webinar and given link, circulated it in time. I also thank one and all who has supported directly and indirectly to make this event success. Thank you, one and all. Thank you.
Thank you very much, the organizing team, for giving me this opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.